Hello and welcome back. In this lecture, I'm going to talk about two technologies which are often discussed in context of cloud computing. First, we'll look at NoSQL databases, and later part of the lecture, we'll talk about MapReduce. Both of these technologies are mainly targeted for handling massive data sets. We'll look at some of the important characteristics of both of these technologies in subsequent files. Let us start by looking at NoSQL databases. Basically, NoSQL means not only SQL, and these databases emerged from the need to process huge amounts of data, and the data was such that it did not require any relational model, and the main requirement was fast storing and retrieval of huge amounts of data in a more efficient manner than what was possible with the traditional relational database systems. And in this kind of data sets, huge data sets, the relationships between various data elements was not much important. An example use cases for this kind of data sets were internet server logs, social media posts analysis, and analyzing large sets of remote sensing data received from various satellites and other sensors, and other data sets like stock market feeds from different stock exchanges. And there are several NoSQL databases that have matured and that have emerged today. Simple DB, HBase, MongoDB, Redis, etc. are some of those. So as I said, the NoSQL databases started becoming popular from early 2009, and mainly they were targeted for addressing web-scale data storage needs. And some of the important characteristics, and we will go in more detail shortly about those. Some of the major characteristics were that these NoSQL databases were non-relational in nature. They were schema-free, and they were highly distributed and used replication for redundancy and other availability requirements. And you could do horizontal scaling by simply adding more machines. And they offered eventual consistency for the data storage. And they were designed to support huge data sets. So what does non-relational mean in this context? NoSQL databases do not follow any relational database model for storing data. That is, they do not have any fixed column tables with relations between them. For example, you may have in a typical relational database management system like MySQL, Oracle, etc. Your applications may have to define schema with where you will create tables and establish relationships between those tables. In a NoSQL database, you do not have that kind of database storage. And often, NoSQL databases do not support data manipulation by using standard SQL interfaces. And also, they do not provide the ACID transaction properties as are available in a normal RDBMS system. However, most NoSQL databases will provide eventual consistency model. Now, let's look at what it means when I say schema-free. It means that NoSQL databases do not follow a fixed schema for its various entities. That is, two records for a single entity may have different properties. And often it is the application code that defines the schema. And as a result, you may not be able to do a join type of an operation, which is often available in a relational database management system. And as a result of these properties, it may be often possible to directly load the data from a programming language construct like an object or a data type that you may have defined in a programming language. To give you a quick example, what does schema-free means? Let's say in a regular relational database management system, you may have an entity called person, which is modeled as a regular table, which may have, let's say, a primary key column, and then you may have a first name column, and then let's say last name column, and then let's say age. And you may have different records here in this table, such that each record here, like primary key, let's say 1, 2, and 3, all of these records which this table contains, they have all of them, each record has these three same properties. Whereas in case of a NoSQL database, your entity does not follow a fixed schema. So you may have things like, you may have a key column, let's say key attribute specified. And then you may have, let's say, first name as before, and then you may have, let's say, last name, and then you may have age. So First row may have, let's say, just these two properties defined. The second one may have just this one and the third one defined. Third one may just have last two defined. It doesn't mean that this is null. What I'm saying is that the storage space, let's say, that is taken only by these. The particular instance of person here, let's say this also defines the entity named person. Here in this case, this third instance of the entity person has just two properties defined, let's say. Whereas the second one has a different set of two properties. The first one may have all the three defined. And contrast this with the RDBMS case. Here, all the records in the table will have to have the values as per the definition of the table. They may be non-nullable. All of these columns may be non-nullable, in which case all these values for each record, all of these column values for each record have to be non-null. So that's what we mean by schema free. That is, two records can have different properties. It's not just the different values. Let me underline this fact. It is actually different properties. So that has to be taken note of. Now, we also said that the NoSQL databases are highly distributed and use replication for high availability. So the main reason is that the primary goal of NoSQL databases is to provide scalability for the applications. So they are designed ground up for that. And to achieve this, often you will have the data partitioned and put on different machines. And this allows easy horizontal scaling. That is, you can simply throw in more machines into the cluster and it automatically scales. And a restriction that you have to impose to allow this kind of a horizontal scaling in the presence of data partitioning is that you lose some strict consistency mechanism. In NoSQL databases, you will end up having only the eventual consistency for your data. And in a previous lecture, we have already looked at what it means in detail. And since the system uses replication with the distributed nodes, that allows you to have some amount of redundancy, which means you can have better fault tolerance. So now let's look at major categories which are possible in NoSQL databases. So often they fall into these three categories. One is key value stores, second is document stores, and then graph stores. And there may be further subdivisions or specializations of these, but these are the major top level ones. So in case of key value stores, they do not have any fixed schema as we just saw. And each data item can have different number of attributes and each attribute may be of different data type. The example of this type of a key value store is Amazon's DynamoDB. And in case of document stores, there is a notion of document which is central to the idea of document stores. And often a document will be encoded by using some encoding mechanism. For example, you may have a JSON structure which could encode the information in the document, or you could use XML or YAML type of encoding. And these documents can be organized in the data store, in a NoSQL data store, in a variety of ways. Often it could be a collection or a directory hierarchy containing the documents. So some of the examples are SimpleDB and MongoDB. And there are a variety of applications which use both of these NoSQL data store types. And particularly, as we will see in the subsequent part of the lecture, key value stores are heavily used in MapReduce jobs. So the third one is a graph database. And this is primarily designed for storing data in which the relations can be best represented as a graph. That is, the elements are connected via a number of relations between them which are not predetermined. For example, you may have a network topology or social relations, like in social media websites, and also transport road links, etc. They can all be modeled as graphs. And some of the examples of this class of NoSQL databases is Neo4j, OrientDB. So these are some of the open source projects which provide the implementation for NoSQL graph databases. So what is the relationship with the cloud? Technically speaking, there is no dependency as such between NoSQL and cloud. A NoSQL database can work equally well both on cloud as well as non-cloud environments. That is, you do not have to have the subscription for a cloud service to install or make use of a NoSQL database. The only relation that you may think of is that the NoSQL databases can benefit from the elasticity of cloud resources. That is, when you want to scale out, it is very easy to achieve dynamic scaling because the cloud provides you to have easy programmatic provisioning of extra resources. So let's say if you have set up your NoSQL database on a cluster of machines, and in order to take care of more processing needs, more request loads that your application has to support, it's easy to scale these databases on a cloud-based platform. So that is the only connection that it has with cloud. Other than that, there is no technical dependency whatsoever. Now let's look at the second technology, which is often talked about in context of cloud. It is called MapReduce. So MapReduce is a programming model for allowing you to process huge data sets. And often these data sets are a collection of key value pairs that you have to process. And it is based on a tactic of divide and conquer. That is a basic tactic used in MapReduce frameworks. And in order to make best use of MapReduce, the problem itself has to be parallelizable, data parallelizable. That is, you can divide the data, large data set, into smaller chunks, which you can process in parallel. Like some piece of logic is applied to each of these chunks of data. And it also often leverages the locality of data to avoid transmission overheads when you have to copy data from a particular storage place to the place where the actual computation on that data is happening. So often there are frameworks like Hadoop which try to put data closer to the processing elements so as to avoid the communication overheads of that are involved in transmission of data. So what are the logical steps? At a high level, it has just two steps. First is called map and then reduce. Typically, in the map step, a large input data set is taken by some piece of code, often the driver part of your code, the driving part of your code, and it splits the large data set into smaller subsets. And the smaller sets are distributed over some worker nodes. And it can actually happen in a hierarchical manner. That is, these worker nodes may still further divide the chunks into even smaller chunks. And each worker node basically runs some logic, some computation on it, and reports the results back to the master node. And then in the reduce step, what happens is the master node combines all the results that it has received from various worker nodes and generates the output. And again, this is a very high level view of what happens in the typical steps in a MapReduce kind of a program. Now let us look at one example scenario. So in this case, we are trying to count the words in a set of text documents. So let's say you have an input which comprises of two files. The first one, let's say, says this particular text line, and the second one has this piece of text. And we want an output which gives us the occurrence of word in each of those files. For example, with this sample data input here, as I have indicated, the expected result is like this. Now, in a MapReduce implementation, this is how the pseudocode will look like. So you will have a map function that the user has to provide. And then you will have a reduce function which looks like this. There are several implementations that are available for MapReduce. One popular open source implementation is Hadoop from Apache. So I have not gone into details of how you would set up Hadoop on a cluster of nodes and what are the setup related steps involved. But from the user standpoint, from the developer who is trying to use this framework, all you have to focus on mainly is these two functions, writing these, modeling your problem such that you are able to extract it into these two functions. In the first one, you will, in our example, what you will do is in the map function, you will take the individual files and try to count the word. For each word, you will emit on each occurrence the number one. And in the reduce step, what you will do is you will have the word, which is the key here, and the values will be a collection which each of your worker node will have returned, and you just simply sum each of those counts and finally emit the total number of counts for each word. So in that way, you will be able to add the occurrence of each word as you have received by processing all of these input files, which in our case happen to be two. Let's look at the execution flow, then it will be slightly more clearer. So what happens when the program executes is that the main will execute first, and it will fork to start new worker processes which can possibly be on different cluster nodes. And let's say it starts different worker processes on those nodes, like the worker 1, worker 2, worker 3, and so on. And the input file is partitioned. Input file in our example case was containing some text in which we wanted to count the number of occurrences of different words. And each worker will then read its chunk of data and perform the computation, which in our case happened to be the emitting of the number 1 for each word it encounters. And then it writes the results locally, the outcome of its own computation, to a local storage here. And this is done by every worker for its own chunk of data. So this completes the map phase. And then in the reduce phase, what happens is the worker nodes, which are assigned the reduced task, they will be doing a remote read from the storage on which the map phase workers had written their intermediate results. And these workers in the reduce phase, they will be combining the results obtained from different map phase, combining the results obtained from the map phase workers to produce the final output here, which they write onto the output files. So this is the overall flow, again at a higher level. But this illustrates essentially the how you use the divide and conquer tactic to divide a huge data set into smaller chunks and assign it to different worker nodes, each of which will produce, do the part of the work and write the intermediate results to their local storage. And then the worker nodes which execute the reduce phase, they will be reading the intermediate results to combine them to produce the final output. So that is the essence of this whole MapReduce framework. And of course, I have skipped several low-level details of how you set up an actual MapReduce implementation such as Hadoop. And there are several steps that are involved in such kind of a case. But in this lecture, I'm not going to go into those details. So what are the applications? Again, as we have seen, mostly we are looking at massive data sets, such as the processing of web link graphs and web server access logs analysis, etc., and document clustering, for example, or stock exchange feeds. And one of the popular implementation, open source implementation of MapReduce is Apache Hadoop, and it abstracts several low-level cluster management tasks, such as job scheduling, that is, how do you split a large data set and schedule it onto different cluster nodes. These kind of low-level tasks are implemented and handled by the framework itself, and it offers an API where a programmer is required mainly to write a high-level functions where they will code their own map and reduce logic as it applies to a specific problems that they are trying to solve using MapReduce. And what is its relationship with cloud? Again, as we saw in case of NoSQL, technically there is no dependency between MapReduce and cloud. That is, a MapReduce implementation does not require a cloud to work. Basically, it can work equally well on a non-cloud environment. But again, it can benefit immensely from the elasticity of cloud resources, because both of these, as we saw in case of NoSQL here also, these frameworks, these technologies were developed for massive scalability, achieving massive scalability when dealing with certain types of data sets, certain types of problems. And cloud being very elastic in nature when it comes to resource provisioning, it becomes natural that you try to leverage the cloud technologies when you implement solutions that make use of both of these technologies, that is NoSQL and MapReduce. So the relationship of both of these technologies, that is NoSQL and MapReduce, with cloud is only up to as much as they just want to leverage the properties of a particular cloud-based platform. Beyond that, there is no dependency per se between any of these technologies. So that is pretty much it for this lecture. Thank you.